Toni Morrison through medium and morality. In this video essay, I will argue how Toni Morrison was able to craft a unique storytelling method by blending African American Vernacular English with African proverb and folklore in conjunction with modern day complexities of race and identity.
My little saying is, one person cannot raise a child. Neither can two. You need everybody. You need everybody you know.
There is vast speculation about the origin of the proverb, "It takes a village to raise a child." Some researchers place it back to Nigeria as an Igbo proverb. Others place the proverb under Swahili origin. In fact, some researchers identify Toni Morrison as the first person to bring a variation of this proverb to the United States. Although origin may be unclear, the concept of communal responsibility for raising moral people is one that Toni Morrison draws from in her works. In Beloved, the "It Takes a Village" proverb presents itself center stage. When Beloved, Seth's pained child, is overwhelmed by an angered spirit, and the community of women approach this tension together as a village in order to reestablish order and peace within Setha, Beloved, and the village itself. Similar to the "It Takes a Village" proverb, the tar baby folktale has no single place of origin. However, in America, it is widely known from the Joel Chandler Harris version in his book, Uncle Remus, His Songs and Sayings. The story is that Harris, a white teenage journalist, overheard the tar baby story on a Georgia plantation and wrote it in the voice of Uncle Remus, the stereotypical complicit black slave, a character that will become a world-renowned figure, and I would argue, introduce literary minstrelsy in the comedic black speech pattern.
Tar baby, stay still.
And Bruh Fox, he lay low. "You stuck up, that's what you is," says Bruh Rabbit, says he. "And I'm gwine to kill you, that's what I'm gwine to do," says he.
The original proverbial message from the tar baby folktale navigates the trickster, the under-resourced Bruh Rabbit, who has to find a way to feed himself somehow, and the dumb master, the Bruh Fox, who believes he has outwitted the trickster, but is fooled into throwing him into freedom, in this case, the Bruh Patch, with food and resources. So the lesson is, a sticky situation gets more sticky the more you mess with it. However, before Joel Chandler Harris could repurpose the tale and racially undermine the black voice, there was also a sense of power from the tar baby tale that exemplified resistance and intelligence in the form of an under-resourced community and in the form of the Bruh Rabbit. In Tar Baby, Morrison creates a conflict so similar to the lived duality of existing black and being enough. In this and in many of her works, we see patterns of lived black experience become lessened as they navigate tension between characters we see ourselves in. In this case, those characters are Sun and Jadeen. Morrison writes, "Each knew the world as it was meant or ought to be. One had a past, the other had a future, and each one bore the culture to save the race in hands. Mama spoiled a black man, will you mature with me? Culture-bearing black woman, whose culture are you bearing?" Let's say for definition purposes, Sun in Tar Baby represents a nationalist perspective, while Jadeen presents a more passive, assimilative perspective. Now circling back to the folktale that shares a name with the novel, Morrison invites the reader to engage with not only different portrayals of blackness, but also Morrison wants the reader to engage with the world as it was meant or ought to be. As Linda Krumholz, author of Blackness and Art in Toni Morrison's Tar Baby, states it, "The desire to know and the danger of knowing is the true hindrance of the black perspective. It is the rabbit stuck to the tar baby."
You know, the language of average, a poor African Americans is always discredited, as though it was impossible for them to speak or they were stupid. But there was this incredible merging of new language and biblical language and sermonic language and street language and standard that created a third thing for me.
A third thing?
a third kind of way of expressing yourself. They had, they pulled from all the places.
The Bluest Eye, a story that follows Picola Breedlove and her obsession of white beauty in direct contradiction to her own value and beauty. Morrison uses the convention of black English in moments of dialogue and reflection to further craft a vivid narrative that doesn't undermine the brilliant ways black people spoke in intimate setting. Throughout the novel, Morrison uses black English conventions in dialogue. Also, rather than vocabulary, Bluest Eye is filled with call and response, which is another black speech pattern derivative from the African diaspora. This all to say, the Bluest Eye allows for black readership accessibility, an aspiration for the black community of readers and writers.
Children.
Does your writing have a political point of view?
Oh, yeah. The truth I happen to be most interested in has to do with the nature of oppression and how people survive it or don't. It's amazing to me, particularly for African Americans, just amazing that we're not all dead. That's a constant shocker. Well, there's a certain kind of moral leadership that could help. I mean, the contempt for poor people, the contempt for difference that is everywhere, in education, in politics, everywhere, is part, it's not just school responsibility. I mean, imagine raising your children to despise other people. Imagine living in a world in which you're perfectly willing to trash an entire, all of your big cities, to flush all of the big cities down the toilet because of the word inner city, which means those people who live there, or to trash your whole public school system, to sink it, in other words, because of the contempt for those people.
Toni Morrison's presence and her ability to exemplify the morality mentioned in her novels by crafting narrative through education, social commentary, and activism is a method of storytelling that influenced how one read her novels. One was not reading a work absent from the creator. Moreover, Toni Morrison's written presence and spoken, lived presence was consistent in her dedication towards the upliftment of black peoples and black morality, and finally the truths of the white gaze. I believe in order to measure an artist's legacy, you have to identify the impact that they have made on culture and society. Here are some examples of how Toni Morrison has impacted the black storyteller perspective.
What I admire most about Mrs. Morrison is her dedication to telling black stories and how unapologetic she was in that. And she wasn't afraid to look critics in the eye and say that if you don't get it, then it's not for you and I'm not required to write for you, which is the white gaze. And she was also editing the books of people like Angela Davis and Huey P. Newton. So she was essentially like being a black revolutionary by helping other black people be revolutionary.
We die, that may be the meaning of life, but we do language, that may be the measure of our lives. Toni Morrison is essential when we talk about literature. It's crazy, I took an American literature class that was supposed to span 200 years of American literature, and she was nowhere to be found or seen. But her legacy survives through the characters that she brought to life, through the stories that she brought to life, and her legacy will live forever.
I think the way she writes is, you know, non-linear and cyclical, and that mirrors the way that black communities, black diaspora communities, have always told stories. There is an element of performance in her work. Like in jazz, you can see how she was inspired by that art form. She incorporates alliteration and repeats phrases and words. And there's a rhythm to that story. Morrison encourages us to see that there are so many stories, I think, to be told, even if they're fragmented, and that you can those pieces together and still create something really beautiful.
Toni Morrison set the bar for what it means to tell black stories in black voice. The way that she went inside of our journey as a people, to help us understand not only the trauma, but the power of our survival, the nuance of our characters, our freedom, and our fear, and our inner turmoil, and our vision. There's none like her.
Toni Morrison's vision for laying the foundation for its future experimental black creatives, armed with lessons, history, and ideas brought to life by the work of Toni Morrison, Africana folklore, and the ancient griots of black culture, has played a major role in creating validity and accessibility to black stories for black people.
Thank you.